right, praise God. It makes you want to go on a missions trip, doesn't it? Yeah, praise God. And there's, so there's sign-ups in the back, and so hopefully you'll pray about it, ask the Lord to show you, and maybe he'll help you, you know, see that you need to go and be a part of that missions trip. It's not a long way away as far as distance from here to there, and so it's kind of a good one to go on if you like, I don't know if I want to go, you know, like, my first missions trip was to Romania, and holy cow, that's a long way away, and get on the other side of the earth and call home, and my son gets on, I told him this the other day, I don't know if he remembered it or not, but he gets on and he says, Dad, I want you to come home. Where are you? Why aren't you coming home? And I was like, oh, I'm on the other side of the earth. But, you know, you have to be ready to go when you go. So, you know, buddy. My buddy, my bro, my dog. Hey, let's stand together. Can we do that? Woohoo! All right. Well, praise the Lord. Today, we're going to go to the Lord in His Word. But first, I wanted to give you a heads up on this booklet that's being, it will pick one up at the back. It's a 21-day church challenge. We've written this booklet and printed it right here. I'm telling you, Sheila worked like a dog on Thursday to get this thing done. Just everything happening with my mom and that all that situation and then other things in life. But pick up this 21-day church challenge. It's 21 days until Easter. 21 days of a daily devotion. And man, I don't even hardly dare open this thing because it is so powerful. I mean, you open this thing up and man, power comes right out of it, right? Just barely crack it a little bit and you get like filled with the Holy Spirit too. It's like, whoa! God just comes right through it. So make sure you get your 21-day church challenge and follow us every day, one a day, vitamins, spiritual vitamins, until Sunday, Easter Sunday. And I promise you by that time, you'll be so ready to reach somebody for Jesus Christ. You'll be able to say, I'm so full of God. I'm just filled with the Holy Spirit. I am right on track, right where I need to be. And in 21 days, you may have started looking like this. And in 21 days, you're going to be like that. Buff. That's right, Lonnie. You got it, man. Give us a... Amen. Are you with me today? So pick up your lifestyle evangelism 21-day church challenge written right here in-house by the pastors and staff here at this church. And so you'll be blessed by that. Would you turn with me if everybody brought your sword with you? Did y'all bring your swords? If you don't have a sword, there's a sword in the sheath right there in front of you. It's a red one. And it's placed there by none other than the Gideons. So in Matthew, let's turn to Matthew chapter 4. And I'm going to read to you one verse that we've been reading here in this series, this Follow Me series. And today it says, we're just going to read verse 17. Matthew chapter 4, verse 17. It says, Jesus speaking, and he's preaching this. Everybody say, he's preaching. He's preaching, and he says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Now, this is an important thing. Everybody look this way quick. This is important, because your eternity is at stake. When Jesus says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand, what you do on earth and where you go in heaven is at stake. This is a serious word from Jesus. He says, repent. That means that you have to repent in order to get into the kingdom of God, to get into the kingdom of heaven. I know that the world and even the church is, the church in general has said, it's not that hard. You don't have to worry about it. Just be a good person. No, that's wrong. Jesus said, repent of your sin. That means you have to recognize that you're a sinner and say, in Jesus' name, without Jesus, I will not make it to heaven. So I accept his plan of salvation because the kingdom of heaven is at stake. And I want to be in relationship with God and I want to go to heaven for eternity. If that's you, then let's see what else God has for us today. Turn with me on back to Matthew chapter 18. Everybody's going to say when we're done reading Matthew 18, the verses, the first 14 verses, you're going to say, man, what's going on with our message today? What is this about following me? Everybody say, follow me.
Follow me.
Jesus said, come and follow me and what? I'll make you fishers of men. So he says, follow me. Now, everybody thinks following Jesus is just going to be easy. It's peaches and cream and everything just going to be rosy. And you can do whatever you want to do. Just go out and have a great life, a great time. But that's while all that is intended, and God hopes that for you and really wants that for you. He's going to tell you something that in the body of Christ, we have to deal with some things from time to time. Amen? And I think the way we deal with them always has to be done with love, smile on our face, and yet, hey, let's take care of business. Let's get this thing taken care of. Amen? So let's look in Matthew chapter 18, and we'll read 14 verses here. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus saying, who then is greatest in the kingdom of heaven? And Jesus called a little child to him and set him in the midst of them and said, assuredly, I say to you, unless you are converted and become as little children, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, I got to stop right there because that's just too powerful. He says, you must come as a child. That doesn't mean you go back to be a child. You still need to be mature. But he says, you need to be converted. First he said, repent. And conversion can't happen until repentance. So many people want to just be a Christian without repenting and actually admitting to their sin. You see, there's something about that we have to relearn in the body of Christ. Is that we have to repent and we have to call sin, sin. And then we can be converted. So he says, act as a child, come to him meek, as a child. And he's not saying everybody goes back to a child, nor is he saying only children can be saved. He's saying, come as a child. Verse 4, therefore, whoever humbles himself as this little child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Whoever receives one little child like this in my name receives me. Let me tell you something, church. We want to receive people into the body of Christ. Amen? That's our job at this church. Our job at this church is to make people feel welcome when they come in here. Our job is to make people feel like they can be a Christian. They can walk with Jesus Christ all the days of their life. They can be filled with His Spirit and have a change of heart and change of life so that when they die, not only will their life have reflected Jesus Christ, but when they die, they'll go to heaven and be with Jesus for eternity. That's something you don't want to miss. My mother used to tell me all the time when I'd go out carousing and doing things I ought not to be doing, she'd say, honey, come home. And be home safe and don't make bad decisions, because missing heaven is not worth it. You can't afford, she said. You can't afford to miss heaven. It's going to be too beautiful. So let's read on. He says, whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were drowned in the depth of the sea. God's serious about sin. Amen? And he's serious about the body of Christ doing what we're supposed to do to lead people to Jesus Christ. He's saying, man, it'd be better for them if they had a millstone. I don't know about you, but I can't swim very good with a millstone wrapped around my neck. And so he's saying, and thrown into the deepest part of the sea, not in a wading pool, but in the deepest part of the sea. Woe to the world because of offenses. For offenses must come, but woe to that man by whom the offense comes. If your hand or foot causes you to sin, cut it off and cast it from you. It's better for you to enter the life lame or maimed, rather than having two hands or two feet to be cast into the everlasting fire. And if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you. It's better for you to enter into life with one eye rather than having two eyes to be cast into hell fire. Take heed that you do not despise one of these little ones. For I say to you that in heaven their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven. Can you imagine angels looking at the face of the Father? And when the Father maybe just sees one of his children, you or me, this is not about just little kids, this is about you. You're one of his little children. Could you imagine the angels who are watching the face of God? And he just goes, I wish that guy would get it down there. I wish Rick would get that thing straight. I wish people in the body of Christ would get this going, man. God has great hopes for us, great dreams for us. And so reading on, he says, take heed that you do not despise one of these. Verse 10, for I say to you in heaven, their angels are always seeing the face of the Father who is in heaven. For the Son of Man has come to save that which is lost. What do you think? If a man has 100 sheep and one of them goes astray, does he not leave the 99 and go to the mountain to seek the one that is strayed? And if he should find it, assuredly, I say to you, he rejoices more over that sheep than over the 99 that did not go astray. Even so, it is not the will of your Father who is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this opportunity today to speak about the body of Christ and how important we are, Lord, to the world. Without the body of Christ, without the church, and doing what we are called to do, to love one another as you have loved us, to help each other, to teach each other, train each other, convince each other, encourage and commit our sins to each other, and that we be healed with each other. Thank you, Father, for all these things that you're showing us today. May we, as we sang this morning, we, Lord, accept it when you speak truth into our lives, and may we make adjustments when we hear that truth. And now, Lord, I ask that each one of us would hear your word today in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Last week we talked about how important the kingdom of heaven is and what's at stake. Scripture speaks to us today about personal and membership type, the way the body of Christ operates. Whether we want to go to heaven or not, I believe every single one of us know that we can have a fulfilled life on this earth, and that we will want to go to heaven and spend eternity with Jesus Christ. So many people have expectations that they have expectations of the church that are too high, and they have expectations of the church that are too low. This facility is just made of wood and concrete and mortar. When I say the body of Christ, I'm not talking about the church physically. This place where we, this is a place that facilitates us to have corporate worship. You see, this place is thank God it's paid for. It's ours. You participated in that last $70,000 of paying this building off. Hallelujah. But you know what? We paid it off not so that we would be more spiritual. Paid it off so we wouldn't have any debt, and that we would gather together and we wouldn't have any overhead. We would be able to do more. We could reach the community better. We might be able to expand someday. All those things happen because we don't have all that overhead. Now listen, the body of Christ, though, is you and me. And the person sitting next to you and across the table from, or across the aisle from you, and those sitting in churches all around the world today, and those people who love Jesus Christ, is the body of Christ. Now I have a message today that I hope will help bring you back to what I believe God has for us and what God wants for us. And that message is not about joining a church. It's about joining the church and being the church. We have to be the church together. Being the church means more than just being with it or on it or in it. It's being the church. Every fiber of the church must be what each of us brings as talents and gifts and associations. See, joining a church, becoming a member, which I'm all for. We have membership this Wednesday night and the next Wednesday night. You got to attend both nights. But that membership class doesn't make you a Christian any more than being a car putting you... makes you a car by being in the garage. If you're a car, cars go to garages. That's what they should do. When they go in, when we're done with our car in the evening, you know, unless your garage is full of junk, you should park your car in the garage. It will thank you for it in the morning. But listen, just because a car goes in the garage doesn't necessarily mean it's operable. That car has to have maintenance. It goes to the garage to be fixed and to be repaired. I refuse to take my truck, my Ford pickup. And take it to somebody who says, yeah, just bring it on in the yard here and I'm sure I can figure out what's wrong with it for you. I do this on the side. Yeah, go ahead and drop it off, leave the keys in it, nobody gonna touch it, and we'll fix it for you. Not saying, I'd rather pull up and some guy come out with his little Ken name tag on there, you know, and at least I know he knows his name that way, you know. If it's upside down, then you know you're in trouble, okay, because then he's got to check it all the time. But he wants you to know his name is Ken. And he can fix your car for you, because you go into his little shop and you see the plaques on the wall certified this, certified that. That means the boy has been learning some stuff, understanding some things, and he's not just for the first time tinkering on my $35,000 truck. Would you agree with that? Now, I know y'all own $50,000 trucks, so you know what I'm talking about. I have to buy the used ones. Been around for a while. I don't like the overhead, but you know what I'm talking about. If I pull in, I want that mechanic to say, mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. When I tell it, it kind of goes, oh, yeah, I can fix that. Yeah, I understand what you're talking about. And they put what's called a tester on it, and the computer on the truck tells the tech what's wrong with itself. And he fixes what's wrong with the truck that way. It's different than the old day. I got that 61 Chevy pickup. I love my old 61. My dad bought it brand new in 1961. I guess that makes sense. It's a 61 and he bought it brand new. He would have bought it brand new in 61. But she's got like a billion hundred thousands of miles on her. And she's just sitting out in the field right now. But pretty soon, when we get the garage done, she'll be in the garage. He or she, whatever it is. And we'll be going through it with a fine-tooth comb. It doesn't have no onboard computer. It just has humans on board, and it runs off of mechanics. It just runs because it knows what to do already, because it was designed to do that. But you see, just because I park it in the garage doesn't make it run right. And it's the same way with the body of Christ. You see, we need to come to the church, to the body of Christ, because there we can be fed, not only by the pastor, but also equally, just as powerful, by connection groups, by other people speaking into our lives, by going to coffee with someone that you met at the church and became friends with, because you love them and they love you, and you begin to say, hey, you know, you commit some things, you share some things, and what happens over coffee has to stay over coffee, amen. And you begin to share those things, and you confess your sin, and the body of Christ begins to develop and become strong. And that's how a good, positive church stays positive, is because we're working and interactive and interrelative. We're working together. And so we have to see that God wants us to be a part of something very powerful. The bride of Christ is called the bride of Christ because it's the people of God that have gotten saved, are coming into relationship with Jesus Christ, who is the groom, and we're called the bride, and he's called the groom. You see, working together, we are not cars, but we need maintenance, and we need help, and we need, is there anybody here that owns a car that never needs fixed? Is there anybody here that owns a car that never needs gas? Is there anybody here that owns a car that never needs tires? I've noticed that my truck sitting out in the field out there doesn't need tires, and it doesn't need gas, and it does not need repair, because I'm not using it, so it don't need it. It can sit there, and those tires are just letting it go down into the dust. And pretty soon, when those old brake pads and everything, the rotor, it doesn't have rotors, it has drums. So pretty soon, the drums will be in the dirt. And pretty soon that'll not be good enough for the earth to have taken back. And pretty soon the muffler will be down in the dirt. And pretty soon the whole bottom pans will be down in the dirt. And you know what? I don't have to put nothing on it. You know, sometimes that's the way it is with the body of Christ. We don't do repairs. We don't do maintenance. We don't get back to the church where we can be retreaded and retrained and put back together, change the electronics, which the mouse ate, by the way. The mice have eaten everything on that truck. I don't even look at it anymore. I want a new truck. Julie, I want a new truck. I want a new 61 Chevy pickup. They don't make them anymore. Don't make them. See what I'm saying? So the church, the body of Christ, we kind of need to be retreaded, to be retrained. Now you know this. Without us, the rest of the world goes to hell. The rest of the, if the church is not strong, people like you and me, all of us in our place, doing what God has called us to do with our talents. Listen, nobody should be sitting on their talents. They shouldn't be sitting on their hands. They shouldn't be sitting doing idle things. Everybody should be about their Father's business. Every single person. Amen? And if we work together, we can do some pretty great things. Now, I need a couple of ushers to come up and help me for an illustrated message. And let me tell you what, I get a little bossy. So let's go ahead and do it. Come ahead, Pops. We're going to need your help. You're an usher. Look at him. Run, Pops. Let's see you run. All right, good. Way to go. So come help us, Pops. All right. All right. What else? What else you got? Okay. Yep. And I want that on the table. There you go. Could you turn it the other way? Not that one, the other one. Yeah. There you go. Nope, the other way. There you go. That's good. Oh, too far to the right. You can move to the left a little bit. There you go. There we go. Good. Now, where's the nails at? Oh, there's the nails. Would you take a nail out and put it on the table for me, please? There we go. That's good. Oh, there we go. Pops, would you set that hammer down on the table? No, not like that. Just lean it up against the wood. There we go. The wood, there we go. Other way. Could you do it the other way? There we go. No. There you go. Good. That's fine, too. Do we have some nails out there? How many? One? I need two. There's two more gathered in his name. Okay. Go ahead and put two out there. I want the good one. Yeah, the one that's stuck on the side won't go with the other ones. He's stuck, right? Could you show the... Oh, he's even bent. That's even better. Okay, good. All right. Now, what else we got? Oh, the wire. Could you set the wire down on... Because we don't want anything on top of the tabernacle. There we go. All right, good. Give the guys a hand, would you? Woo! Thank you, guys. Now, I need a couple of helpers. Let's see. Who would like to help me this morning? Somebody with strong hands. Jerry, why don't you come along and help me with strong hands? Jerry, there we go. Sheldon, come and help me. Yep. All right. And we need a lady. Jerry, come ahead and help us. Somebody like that. Now, Jerry, you are the... Hi, Bev. Keep from laughing. You are the brains of this organization. You cannot touch a tool, but you can tell them which tool to use and which ones, when to grab it and how to use it. You are the brains, but you cannot touch anything. You can't even point at anything. You can just use your voice. Okay? Now, I want you to hold that. There we go. And I also want you to hold that. Because there's somebody that it can be used, but they got to be straightened out. Amen? Now, I want you to take that. Now, let's see. Sam, where are you at, Sam? I'm missing. Sam, where are you at? Would you come up here? Hey, screw you, buddy. Oh, yeah, here you go. All right, toolbox is open. Now, I need somebody to hold this piece of wood. Who would hold this piece of wood? Jake, break your leg? Come on up, buddy. You just got nominated by Abby. Yeah. All right, come on up here and bend over, buddy. Hey, there's discipline in the body of Christ. Take that wood. It's all yours, buddy. Look, now, sorry I didn't call you back this week. Can we still be friends? Okay, good. All right. I got really busy. Hey, by the way, do you want a good story before we do this thing really quick? Do you want a miracle?
Yes.
On Sunday, last Saturday actually, when I left Longmont, my mom's been in the hospital. She had colitis. She had her colon removed. That's a huge thing. I mean, at 81, it's huge. It's huge no matter what. She hasn't been doing good, and the doctors are like, she doesn't have a will to live. She just isn't able to turn things around. We just can't get her to really get her mind into this thing. So, long story short, I came home Saturday night, and I probably wept all the way from Longmont all the way home. And I bawled like a little schoolgirl to God. I mean, just like, Lord, you know, what's going on here? I'm a pastor of a church. Help me get, you know, I need mom healed. I'm not ready to lose my mommy yet, so to speak. And something just rose up inside of me, faith. And I called my sisters. It was like 10:30 at night. I called them, and I just said, let's just join together and just pray. I know we've been praying, but let's join together and pray for mom to become coherent and that we would have wisdom and we would know what to do to help mom, because the doctors just want to give her narcotics, more pain relief, and maybe there's something else. She just doesn't have a will to live. So the doctor said if she doesn't improve by Monday, we have to call in hospice. She just can't stay here any longer. We can't just keep her, so to speak, just in ICU. She's not strong enough to go anywhere else. She just wants to die. So the nurse had that talk with us. We were like, this is craziness. We serve the risen Savior. And so we prayed, long story short. And Shelly got it in her head, my little sister. She got it in her head. She said, we need to take her off the narcotics and get her on something that takes the pain, but not narcotics. We took her off the narcotics. By Tuesday, she was up and around. By Wednesday, she wanted to live. She said, I'm ready to go forward. That was craziness. It was so selfish. And she said, like, everything was just a cloud. I couldn't even think of it. And let me tell you something. Today, she's released from the hospital. And she's at home. She's at Life Rehab Center in Longmont for therapy and to get. Yeah, isn't that great news? I'll get to go see her probably tomorrow. I'll be with her and have dinner with her tomorrow night. That's great. That's a story that God we want to repeat over and over. And there's more of them coming. We see Bev being healed and walking for her healing, walking through cancer. In the name of Jesus, we just proclaim that. Everybody, just extend a hand towards her right now. Heavenly Father, we just extend our prayer over her, and we just pray for her in the name of Jesus, that you would heal her, and Lord, anoint her, and thank you, Lord. Bev, I'm just going to anoint you with oil right now. This is the Holy Spirit working right here. In the name of Jesus, we just follow the Holy Spirit, and we just anoint you with oil. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and I just anoint your hands. I just anoint you in Jesus' name, all over you. In Jesus' name, we just praise you, Father, for the scripture that she stands on every day of her life to beat this cancer in Jesus' name. Beat this cancer. Thank you, Lord, that you said every name that is named you have placed under the feet of Jesus, and cancer has a name. And so we thank you that this cancer is under the feet of Jesus, and she will not be destroyed, but she will live. And we thank you for this, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Okay, praise God. Woo, hallelujah. Don't you like it when the Lord just kind of goes, I'm going to interject this really quick. Hallelujah. So we have here now this morning I get up and the Lord just kind of changes things on me a little bit. And so I love it when I get to my office, and actually I hate it when he goes, and I'm like, man, I got to get going. You know, I got all this stuff to do. And I just hate that. He's like, so I'm like, okay, illustration time, I can tell. You want to do an illustrated message. So I'm like, okay, what am I going to do? Show the people how a body works together. Show the people how it's not all one person doing everything. You might be a master mechanic. You might be a master carpenter. You might be a master at disaster. But God wants to help you with that. And so I just went out around the shed, and I just grabbed the first piece of wood I saw, and I get it in here, and it's like a boat. It's like Noah's Ark. I didn't plan this. I went outside and looked. I mean to tell you, that is so cool. Anyway, I think I'm more inspired by that than you are. Now, this is somebody. This is somebody out there that's lost. They need to be connected to the body of Christ. Who better than a guy like Jake? I will make you a fisher of men.
Oh, I mean you.
You made me a fisher of fish. Yeah, buddy. Great fisherman. He made me a fisher of fish. But Jesus made you a fisher of men. So now we're responsible for that person to get them to a place where they can stay afloat, where they can stay and participate in life. If without it, they'll die. They can make it on their own for a while, but they need to be a part of the bigger thing. I always tell people, be a part of something bigger than you and make it better. Make it bigger. Be a part of something strong. That's why I tell these kids all the time, be a part of the team and don't you quit. I won't let somebody quit football that started. Once they start, they can't quit. Even if we have to put that helmet on backwards and they wear all the pads backwards, they have to be on the team. They can't leave. And I tell them that right up front. And once you put that helmet on, you're on the team. You don't quit. Amen? We got to teach these kids that. So now, this guy has to be attached to this guy, and you guys have to attach it three different ways, and he's going to coach you through it. You have the tool for one piece here, and the other tool is in here somewhere that you got to find it and coach it, because he's got a different type of screw than what takes a flathead or a Phillips head. So go ahead and get that thing attached. I don't care how it is on there, but probably somewhere on it would be good. Go ahead. See you later. There we go. Oh, that's a good place. Yeah. Oh, just a second. Oh, we have a little bit of a schism in the church. Go ahead. There we go. Okay, now. Oh, wait a second. Rebecca Kesselberg, come on up here. We need an encourager. And if that ain't you, I don't know who it is. Yeah. I don't know who it is. She doesn't talk very much, and when she does, people listen. Her name's E.F. Hutton. Go ahead and encourage him. Go ahead and start encouraging him right now. Whoa! There you can see. There we go. Yeah. All right, good job. Now that person is kind of connected. They might have attended like maybe one of our connection groups, and now they're kind of connected. But there is, you know, we don't force people to stay at River of Life. We don't force them to stay in the body of Christ. If they want to be pulled up, we have the tool to do that, don't we? But we don't want to use that tool. But anyway, now we have another one. Now this person got bent by the church. And there are people like this all the time. And so it's almost like they stay away from the church like fighting your own face. They're just bent. Something harder here and here hit it harder than the metal in between was able to withstand. It was so hard, I just got bent. So we got to straighten them up. Why? Because they're still usable, right? I got a lot of bent nails in my pouch. You go to my pouch, you'll pull more bent nails than straight ones out of my pouch because I save nails, because they can still be used. Plus, they don't want to go to the waste dump. They want to be used for something powerful. So now, straighten that nail. There's tools in the toolbox. Go ahead and help them, encourage them. Tell them how to straighten that nail. Help them out, Jerry. How can they straighten that thing? Look at this, folks. Can you see? Come on. I'm resorting to drinking. Oh, getting closer. Oh, man. Looky there. Now we're ready to be used. Look at that, folks. Good deal. Give them a hand. Now we still got to get it secured. Membership. We got a screw here that's going to really hold things tight. How are we going to get that in there now? We could either go through virgin wood or there might be a hole already drilled there. You got to tell them what to do. That's profound. I'm too old for that. I'm too young for this. You're getting colder. You were hot a second. Oh, now you're hot. You're red hot. You're smoking, Sam. Colder. A fisherman, that would be bass backwards. Yeah. Are we working? Come on, cheer him on, folks. You're the church. Come on, cheer him on.
Samuel,
come on, don't quit. Come on, Sam, you can do it. I know you can. Watch out, the guy with the hammer wants to use it again. Made in China. What do you think? Is that good enough?
No.
No. The Holy Spirit just did that. Trying to help you out with some noises. There you go.
Do it.
Okay, now that's good. That's good right there. Now we need Wi-Fi. So somebody has to put an antenna on that thing. Who is going to do the antenna? Oh, how about Jess? Jess Evans, come and do an antenna for us. Hustle. Oh, there you go. That's good. Antenna. We need about 10 inches long, wouldn't you think, Supervisor? Okay, show. Tell her what to do. How are we going to attach that? Okay, good. Perfect. Because we don't want to miss heaven. We want to go past Jupiter and Saturn. Oh, looky that. Oh, looky there, folks. We're going to get it. We're going to have a boat. We're going to have Noah's Ark with Wi-Fi when it's all done. Yep. Perfect. Give them all a hand. All right, good job. So I know that was kind of a long illustration, but a fun illustration of how the body of Christ works together. I would like it if you would turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. It's amazing to me how many people, Christians mostly, as you're turning to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, will say to me, "Pastor, I love Jesus, but I don't like the church." Have you ever heard that? I got hurt in a church. Yeah, I know. We know how to straighten bent people. We know how to do that. Yeah, but you don't know. The church hurt me this way. The church hurt me that way. Yeah, I know. Get over it. Quit being a victim. Quit being a lone ranger and sitting out there by yourself and stewing and brewing and being self-appointed to be your own self-appointed victim. Stop it. Because it's not biblical. Are you hearing me? And I'm going to prove it to you. It's not biblical. People will say to me, "Oh, Pastor, I love Jesus. I just love Jesus." And they're all spiritual. So spiritual, one lady even told me, she said, "Pastor, I can't come to church. I'm not going to be in church. I'm not going to come to your church." Then she proceeds to tell me how her horse talks to her and tells her spiritual thing. Now, if that ain't goofy, go ahead and spend that $3 bill. That's goofy. That's strange. When somebody says, "I can't stand church," that's like saying, "Man, Jeff, I love you, buddy. I can't stand it." Did you get that? Now, that doesn't mean we don't heal people. We don't want to help them get healed up that have a problem with the church. We want to help them get over it, and we want to help them become a vital part of the church. A vital part, because they're probably very vital, and if the devil has his way, he'll separate them from the church and give them a upset stomach over the thing so they can't be used, because they probably have really valuable gifts that we want, that God can use. Tremendous stuff, and the devil wins when we say, I don't like Debbie. Everybody say, "I don't like Debbie." Aww. No, see, you won't even say that, will you? See, you guys already got this message. I mean, could you imagine somebody saying, "Hey, man, Lonnie, I love you to death, but we just cannot stand Gisette." How would that go over with you? Not well. Not well, right? Would you appreciate that very much? You see? That's right. That's right. We're not going to go on a bike ride together, are we? So when that happens, it kind of breaks my heart, but it's also kind of like, man, that is so sad that somebody was mistreated in a church to the point where they do not want to be a part of the body of Christ anymore. That's hurtful to me when I hear that. And I try to grab them and say, hey, there's two things that need to happen here. First of all, you need to stop being self-appointed to hurt yourself and being a victim. And second of all, you need to understand you'll be loved at our church. I don't know what they do in other churches on Sundays because I don't attend those churches. I come to my church because I have a job to do at my church. And that's to love people the way Jesus loves them. Jesus said that, husbands, love your wives as Christ so loved the church. He gave everything for her. And then he says, you know, in Ephesians, it says, wives, love your husbands, submit to your husbands. Why? Because there's two people doing two different things. And man, when it comes together in one, it's called a family. You know? Here's the church. Amen. You got it. So with that said, are you in 1 Corinthians chapter 12? Look what it says here in verse 1. Now we're going to turn spiritual. Everybody say spiritual.
Spiritual.
Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. Look, a lot of times churches even teach against the gifts of the Spirit. The most beautiful thing in the spiritual realm in the church are the gifts of the Spirit. And yet sometimes we're taught, throw that out, just whoosh, because we don't understand it. We don't want to learn about it. So therefore, let's just take it out. Listen, there's some things that men legislate that we think are okay because we like it and it feels good. But there's some things that God's going to say in heaven when we get to the judgment table. And he's going to say, that ain't in my word and that ain't, I don't approve of that. Y'all can, but I didn't. Amen? And it's going to be some things are going to be said over these spiritual gifts where we're going to be held accountable and responsible for not teaching about spiritual gifts and the body of Christ operating in them together. We're going to have to make sure we don't are not ignorant. So sometimes we fear what we don't know. Amen? Let's just figure out that there's no boogeyman in the closet. Let's get in there. Let's talk about it. Let's take a look real quick in the 10 or 12 minutes that I have left. He says, now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles, carried away to those dumb idols, however you were led. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed, and no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Stopping there really quickly, it is the Holy Spirit that pricks our heart and tells us some things inside of us that we need to change. It's the Holy Spirit that touches us and speaks to us, not a horse. Not an animal. The last time an animal spoke to a man, it was in the Old Testament, and it was a donkey. And God used him because that man would not listen to God. And so God dumped him on his rear and had a donkey talk to him to tell him some stuff because he would not listen to... You don't want that. Listen to God. God only did that once. It's the only time in the Bible, so don't think that it's like common practice. Amen. If your dog or your horse is talking to you, you need to go check into the hospital. Come down here, we'll anoint you with oil, cast that demon out. Either way, we'll help you. Where was I at? Therefore, let's see, verse 4, there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. So he's saying we've got to have unity because it's all coming from one Lord. And there are diversities of activities, but it is the same God who works all in all. And the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. So, each person that might operate in one of these gifts is for the body of Christ. It's to help all of us together. We've been talking about all of us and the kingdom of heaven. It's at hand. How are they going to help us? Look at this. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit. A word of wisdom, in my definition, is something that is spoken by someone else that they're speaking to into your life. Maybe it's a mentor, maybe someone else, or maybe in the body in a service like this, someone might just come to the mic or come to me and just say, Pastor, I have a good word for the church today. Can I share that? And I'll say, well, what is it? Because I don't want you to tell us something you got from a horse. You know what I'm saying? I want you to tell us something you got from the Bible. Amen? Aren't you glad the pastor will make sure that that happens? Because have you ever heard somebody speak through, they talk like Mr. Ed. Really? You know? I think you shouldn't buy a car today. Sorry, I'm meddling now. So I think, you know, the word of wisdom is when somebody comes to you with a wise word that they've been praying about, and they might say something like, you know, I just want to be humble. I want to be operating in this correctly, but I've just been praying for you, and I just think that God might be saying this to you about using wisdom in making that job change, in making that purchase, and making a, you know, maybe making an opportunity here for someone else. I just want to caution you with that. That's called a word of wisdom. It's not that the hydraulic ceiling opens up, and it's not the whole heavens opening up, and just, whoa, and God, bing, comes down, and he speaks a word of wisdom to you. It's probably going to come from somebody that would speak into your life, that loves you, cares for you, cares about you, and God might just give them something called a word of wisdom. Now, that applies to also the next one, which is called a word of knowledge. And the word of knowledge is knowledge from the mind of God about certain places, people, things, situations. You know, I think of some of you people like, you know, Jen, you're a real estate agent. Word of knowledge would really help in those areas. And you know, being a pastor, I really use the word of knowledge a lot. I apply what I can read, and then the Holy Spirit has to take from there. Mechanics, I know Ken, he reads a lot of manuals. He reads a lot of things, and he may not be able to mentally absorb every single thing. But as he studies and as he looks at it, when he gets out to fix a car, he might be able to say, Lord, I just appreciate the knowledge that you give me and the wisdom that you help me with. Heavenly Father, show me, you know, in the areas that I've studied. Of course, you got to do your part to study and work and what have you. But then, you know, maybe you just are able to say, Lord, just show me some wisdom here on this. And you pray about it. You think about it. And if there's something that stumps you or stops you, ask the Lord to help you. God cares about every little thing that you do. And a word of knowledge from someone else or God giving you that word of knowledge will really be helpful. Now let's move on more quickly to the next ones. To another, he says, a gift of faith. By the same Spirit, to another, gifts of healings. By the same Spirit, to another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. Let me stop there for a really quick second. Listen, prophecy isn't like I'm going to call forth some things and I'm going to speak that it, you know, that the sun is going to rise tomorrow morning. That's not prophecy. What we're doing in prophecy now in the New Testament, in the Old Testament, they called out things that hadn't been done yet, which was in the heart of God. In the New Testament, it's done, and we call forth those things which are already in the Word. So when you're teaching in children's church, or in the nursery, or in on Wednesday nights to our young boys in Royal Rangers, or young girls in Impact Girls, or you're teaching an adult Bible study or connection group, you should be prophesying. Come on, we're speaking positive things over these kids, and that's prophetic. You're saying, hey, God has a great plan for you. God has some of these things. And here I'm showing you how to make application to your life so that that little boy, that little girl, as they grow up, we're telling them who they can be, all the things that God has for them, all the things that they are anointed to do and to accomplish, and they'll grow up not thinking I'm going to be doing the things that girl on the video did, but because we'll separate them from that and we'll say, no, that's not who it you're called to be. No one is called to be that. You're called to be this. And God will show them individually as we teach them the word, and they will all know. Now, just think. If I wasn't here to teach you this today, would the church be here? I don't know. God may have raised up someone else. But let me tell you something. There's voids in the whole entire body of Christ. And if we don't fill them, those kids could go untaught. Adults could go untaught. Maybe there needs to be a connection group led by an adult that is specific. That maybe I'd really appreciate like an Alcoholics Anonymous, something for alcoholic recovery. Amen. I really don't prescribe to Alcoholics Anonymous because I don't want you to wake up every day and say I'm a drunk just a day of sobriety. I don't want you to say that. I want you to say, I'm the son of God. I'm a healed son, a daughter of God. I'm a child of God. And I don't think any child of God has that. I'm going to be an overcomer. I'm going to take the genes of my father, the DNA of my heavenly father, and I'm going to overcome this. And I'm not going to say I'm a drunk. I'm going to say I'm the healed. That's because that's what the Bible says to say. I'm the healed. Amen? I'm the healed. Say that with me. I'm the healed. I'm not going to be the guy that's overcome by anything. I'm going to be the healed. So God's talking to us about doing some of these things. Why? Because the body of Christ has to reach out to the world to get them here so that they can be saved. If they're not on the boat or in the boat, they're dead. They won't make it. They can't make it on their own. I'll prove that to you here in just a minute. Let's move on. After prophecy, we see to another discerning of spirits. Moms, you're great at this. You have eyes in the back of your head. To another, different kinds of tongues. To another, interpretation of those tongues. And I know tongues are difficult. People don't like to talk about it. But let me tell you something. The teaching that they're not for today is wrong. And it's not biblical. Because it's here, and it would have said, after a certain date, no longer operate in the things of the Spirit. It says it's still there. We just have to operate it without ignorance and correctly. Next verse. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as he wills. For as the body is one and has many members, but all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greek, whether slaves or free, and have all been made to drink into one Spirit. For in fact the body is not one member, but many. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where would be the smelling? But now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body, just as he pleased. I'm convinced that you're here today because God is trying to set you in this body just as he pleases. You are here today because God is saying, I can set you here. I can plant you here. And you can be very pleasing. And you can be used as a great tool. And it pleases me that you be set in order and submitted to God. Come on, let me share something with you before we move on. I feel this by the Holy Spirit, and it's very transparent. And I'm not happy about it. But I must tell you that as a young boy in my home church, I was abused by my pastor. It was the most hurtful thing in the world to have a man that you trust touch you where you shouldn't be touched. My secret was my secret when he was removed, but I had to tell my dad because of the purpose. My dad was going to beat the hell out of me. Senior pastor stopped him. I had to tell my grandfather. And when my dad died and my grandfather died, I thought, my secret is safe. No one will know. And years after the whole event happened, it came out in the newspapers that this man had gone to other churches and had done it, and it was coming out. And my name was printed in the paper as a victim. I had to call a meeting and tell my family, my children, my wife, my mother, and I had to come out and say, I was abused. That's why I can say to you, I've been there. I could have been a victim. I was the one that was bent. I was the one that wanted to stay away. And I certainly didn't want anything to do with ministry or God in any way, shape, or form. So don't tell me why you're staying away from the church. Because I have every reason to be away from the church. What's your excuse?
Amen.
What is your excuse for staying away from God? I believe in healing. And I believe in health. And I believe that God has done it all for me. And as much as my mother was healed, going to tell you that I'm going to make a life out of being a sexually abused young man. That is not me. No more than a drunk. Once who drank alcohol is now labeled a drunk the rest of the... No, you are the healed and you are a child of God, and that's how I see you. You want to wear my glasses for a while? That's how I see you. You want to wear my glasses, you wouldn't see. You feel the Holy Spirit here today?
Amen.
So let's read on. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. For by one Spirit we are all together. He says about the eye. Verse 22. No, much rather, those members of the body which seem to be weaker are necessary. See, guys like me are necessary. Guys like you that are alcoholic are necessary. We just can't be the healed in here all the time. We need people that are coming in that are hurting. We want those people that are in pain and agony and misunderstood and away from God for any reason. We need them to come in so that they can be used and be put to use and feel used, because that's the way people live when they are needed. When somebody's no longer needed, they quit and they give up and they say, I'm done. Amen. And so, he says, our presentable parts, verse 23, and those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, on these we bestow greater honor. And our unpresentable parts have greater modesty, but our presentable parts have no need. But God had composed the body, having been greater honor to that part which lacks it, that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care for one another. And if one member suffers, all the members suffer with it. Or if one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it. Now you are the body of Christ, and members individually. You see, who's going to play for me, Candace? Listen, church, it's not biblical to be away from the church. It's not. If it is, then go ahead, stand up, and come up here. We're going to chop off your hand, and we're going to see if your hand can make it without the body. Anybody want to do that? Anybody seen a hand out there walking around? I don't know. Do you see an arm out there anywhere in the body, out in the world? Just a body. Oh, hey, hi, arm. How are you, arm? Go, army. That's all I can tell you, bud. Amen. Are you hearing me? There's no ears just out there, just kind of laying there. Hi, I can hear you. Hi. No. Everybody needs to be involved, because if Gil's not here, he's going to pray for the pastor. He comes and prays for me. That's what one of his talents is. He just comes and prays for me. Who's going to be my Jeff? And Jeff can't be strong unless he has a Debbie. Every Jeff needs a Debbie. That's why they make little Debbies. We can all have one now. Sorry, it was getting too serious. I had to make a joke. Hallelujah. And so the Holy Spirit comes with a needle and a thread. And he comes with the word attached. Jesus takes it, and like my grandma used to, you know how they put the thread in their mouth because they can't catch it with their finger and they can't see it. They don't want it to fall through. And then they take that button. Pretty soon that button's on the shirt and it'll hold something. It was done with love and it was done with care. Had to have a thimble so you didn't poke yourself. And you see, that's how the Holy Spirit is, with that needle and thread. He comes along to Phil Caricelli, who I love so much, and he's a brother, and he encourages me, and I encourage him, and we have breakfast together every Tuesday. And we talk about the things of God, and now he's been in the church for 3 years. And he's not the man he started out to be, but if he hadn't come to the church, he wouldn't be the man he is today.
Amen.
I look around, and I see the House family, and I see all these different families. It's like the Holy Spirit just, right through the heart, pulls them to Jesus. Pulls that needle, that needle through that button, gets through the threads of the shirt, gets in there and ties it down securely. Why? Because we don't want that button to come off, because if it does, so the Holy Spirit, while I'm preaching today, going around, knitting people, just as he pleases, to the right place, to the right spot on the shirt, to the right portion of the button, on the back, on the old Levi button-ups, remember those? Each of us get to be a part. Maybe you're the belt and you hold the pants up. Thank God for people like you. Come on, brother. The Holy Ghost is taking this service over anyway, so you got it.
So before I even walked in here,
I have these notes that I had before I even walked in here, and it says, our God is a God of variety. We know this just by looking outside. We don't see one place the same as the other, and that goes for the body of Christ and us believers. We all have gifts that, you know, the other don't have, and we can reach people that others don't or may not be able to reach. You know, I look at Pastor, he's a cowboy, and I look around and there's different people from different walks of life.
You want to be a cowboy, don't you?
Negative.
He wants to be a gangster.
I once was a gangbanger. You know, I thought I was cool. So, like Christian rap I listen to. And it's really helped me grow. And those are people that I can reach. Is the troubled youth. Because I've been there. So, don't keep your gift to yourself and store it away. Make sure you're reaching out to people that he can't reach, I can't reach. And that's all I have to say.
Come here, brother. And I got to tell you something. You talk about a rift in the body of Christ. The devil was trying to get between me and this man. Years before, they came to our church. There was a rift because I was coach at that point. That's all they knew me as. And you know, they didn't appreciate the way I was handling their son. And we won't go into any of that because that's behind us, but some things got straightened out. And it's amazing. They had to have the right heart, and I had to be willing. But we just sat down, and I just said, let's work this out. Because I saw the Castanets are great people. And so we did exactly what the Bible says. If you read on there in Matthew 18, it says, if you have a fault against a brother, sit down with them and work it out. If that person won't hear you, grab someone from the church, an elder or someone in the body of Christ, and sit down with them. And then if that doesn't work, take it to the elders of the church, the pastor, the elders and deacons, and work it out. That's the biblical way.
And I can truly say that he came with humility and said, I didn't do everything right. And I said the same. Mama Bear didn't do everything right.
We love you, Mama Bear.
So, but, you know, if it wasn't for him showing the love of Jesus Christ, we would have stayed.
You know what? In that meeting, you know this, man. I'm just like, devil, take this, man. Take this, devil, because I got one of these for you. You know, in that meeting, you know what I said to I almost called you Mork and Mindy. You know what, Mindy? I said, now that's behind us. Come to my church. I love people that can work stuff out. I love it. That's what we're all about. Because we're not quitters. Amen? We don't quit. There ain't no quitting me. If you want to quit this church, you're quitting on your own. I ain't going to let you quit. You're not going to quit on Jesus. You're not going to quit on God. You're not going to quit on your walk. You're going to score. You're going to make it to heaven. You're going to be on that boat. Amen?
Amen?
If you want to walk away, that's up to you. I'll come try and get you. Because the one is supposed to go get the rest, the one. And leave the 99 behind to go get the one. That one is important. Let me tell you something, church, as we close here this morning. Let me tell you something. Don't be a hand out there separate from the body. Don't be an arm away from the body because it's not biblical. Get healed. Have it put back on. And become usable. We got some little kids back there that need trained up. Don't you dare walk out of this church today without saying, you know what, let's come back next week and let's find that place to serve. Say that to your spouse. Say that to yourself inside. Let's find a place to serve. Let's go talk to Pastor Julie. Let's find that place. Because, hey, there's a place for you. Whether it's teaching alcohol recovery, helping somebody get through a tough situation, a marriage disorder, you name it. We need people that will do that because, listen, I could jump this pews and there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 seats right there open. How many in front of you right there, Isaiah? We got what? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2. That's unacceptable. We can reach other people for Jesus Christ. Come on, man. You love me? Come on, you love me? I'm your pastor, I'm your coach. Let's get these things filled up. Let's get it filled. Give it to God. Give a hand clap to the Lord. Man, there's like a whole row right here. Two people sat here last week and said, we're visiting, we're trying your church, and we're thinking about moving to Wellington. I said, you sat on the front row? They said, yeah, we want to be right in the spit zone. Wow. Man, that was kind of cool. Would you stand with me and let's pray, and then we're going to receive that offering for the vision. In fact, let's prepare our hearts right now, because you know what? The last Sunday of the month, every last Sunday is Vision Sunday. That's today. We cast vision today, didn't we? And we're going to take up an offering. And if you didn't give in the first offering, man, you ought to say, I'm going to give in the second one, because guess what? That one goes directly to our outreach facility called the AMP. Listen to this. 110 kids will go through there a week. Our youth group is huge. Not all of them attend this church. Most of them don't attend church. Would you agree with that, Jen? 110 kids. Listen to this. Five of them on Tuesday night, middle school, got filled with the Holy Ghost. Got filled with the Holy Ghost. Saved and filled with the Holy Spirit. You say, well, what does that mean? That means that they also prayed in tongues, prayed in a heavenly language. Outside there in English tongue, they prayed in an unknown tongue that we talked about today. Amen? Now, you know what? Some of you might say, well, not everybody prays in tongues. Yes, they do. Everybody should pray in tongues. Not everybody will speak in tongues, because that's a gift of the Spirit that's given to a few. And that always has to be interpreted. Always. But every single person, you should go in your prayer closet and pray in tongues. If you don't get what it means, that's okay. But everybody can. You say, I'm not ready for that yet, Pastor. That's good. That's fine. But let's just take a step and see what God does. I've had people that have said, Pastor, I thought praying in tongues was for the birds. And I did too. Until the day I was in my office and I started praying. And the Holy Spirit began to speak to me. And I started praying in tongues. And he basically said these words to me. I'll show you what that's about on Sunday. I kept praying and I kept praying and I kept praying. In my previous job at Rocky Flats as the director of labor relations, I had to fire a kid that I went to high school with that was our star running back in high school. We were hired on the same day. And in his 13th year of working at a job that made over $100,000 a year, he did some things that were so unethical and so benign that we had to fire him. Five years later, I'm praying in tongues. And the Lord says, keep praying. I'm going to show you why you prayed this way. I'm going to show you why. I began to call it out. I began to interpret it. I kept saying, in the name of Jesus, Lord, bring that for which I know nothing of. Bring it to pass, Lord, whatever it is. If I'm supposed to keep doing it, I just keep praying it out. And I prayed out in that other dialect. It was just that Greek word for tongues is dialectos. That's the Greek word. It's another dialect. And it's a spiritual thing that God just says, pray this way. See, if we pray some, wow, you guys got a minute? I'm sorry. I feel by the Holy Spirit I'm supposed to share this. See, if we pray in our English tongue, that's why tongues and interpretation are important. If we pray in our English tongue, we'll tell God what to do every time, the way we think it needs to be done. But if we pray by the Spirit, He'll show us how to say it and what to say. And words have power. It's called twerking. Every time you say something, it not only hits the ears of a child that you tell they're stupid, you're an idiot, why'd you do that, make them feel belittled when we need to correct them the right way, amen, and then correct them so that they can succeed. Everybody say succeed, because our heart's desire is that they succeed. That's quirky. And it begins to take shape. And that's what God did when he spoke. And he said, God used faith. And he used, he's God, especially. And he said, let there be light. Now that we don't have the ability to create like that. He's deity. He's God. Don't get me wrong. But we do have the ability to say, in the name of Jesus, I speak over my son. I speak over my daughter. I speak over my grandchildren. In the name of Jesus, I speak. I call them out. If we know what to say, we'll say it. But when we don't, God gives us the Holy Spirit to say it when we don't know how to say it and what to say. Amen? Are you following me? On that Sunday, I walk into the sanctuary, and there sits the guy that said, "If I see you, I'm going to kill you, Carlson, for firing him." There he sat, right here, about where Bill was at. There he sat. Chris Angelo, star running back. You look it up, he's in the books of the state of Colorado for Longmont High School. There he sits, buffed out. I'm thinking, he came here to kill me in front of my church. No, I just walked right up to him. I said, "Hey, Chris, how you doing?" He stood up and he says, "Carlson, I got Jesus in my heart. And I just wanted to come and tell you about it. Because I heard you as a pastor. I wanted to hook back up with you. I just wanted to go, hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen." That's what being in the body of Christ is all about. Come on, man. Love that person next to you. But love that person outside, on the outside of this church, in this given year. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity in Jesus' name, for this day and for this challenging message. Help us to become that for which you called us to be. And now, Lord, as we receive this offering, we just receive it, Lord, knowing that some kid, maybe in America, I don't understand how it happens, but maybe on the streets and maybe hungry right here in Wellington. Thank you, Lord, that they'll find the amp and we'll grow from not only 110, but 20, 30, 40. But Lord, we'll just grow as you bring them. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now, would you be seated so we can just receive this offering really quickly? Make out your offering to River of Life. If it's a check, if it's cash, then so be it. We gave in first service, but I want to give again. Hold on. I just want to slip one more in there. Thank you. Praise God. Children's Church. As you know, Isaac and Crystal will be leaving in sometime in June, July, August, sometime there, depending on when we get the new youth pastor hired. Update there really quickly. I already have great candidates coming in. I mean, I'm not trying to brag. I'm just trying to tell you the facts. This is a great job to be at. This is a great job to have over at the AM. And Isaac has done such a phenomenal job, Isaac and Crystal, that somebody's coming into this thing ready-made, 110 kids. In the youth group. We're reaching the town. We're not just reaching, you know, most churches will have 10 to 15 kids in their youth group. We have 110 and they're from the community. Isn't that wonderful? Now, the youth group isn't the only means for youth to you know, remain vital in this church. We have rangers that goes all the way to, what age, like 18 or so, you guys? And you guys have come up through that. Now you're involved in the youth and everything else, right? Yeah. And so you're doing kind of both. And the Impact Girls can do the same thing. Right? Where's our girls at? You guys are kind of doing both? Are you? Yeah. That's what I thought. And so it's kind of powerful. Keep them going. Keep them busy. Idle hands make trouble. What's it called? Idle hands? Okay. Do the devil's work? Are the devil's work. We don't want no idle hands, do we? Okay. So praise God. We have a great church. And I'm having candidates coming in here. That want to really have a heart. I'm telling them, you got to have a heart for a community. If you have a heart to just have 10 or 12 kids in your church, that's not good enough. We want those 10 or 12 kids, but we also want 120 or 50 more out in the community. Come on, man. There's what, 400 kids over at the middle school? We got 110 of them? Yeah. That's no longer trying to make the tail wag the dog. We are the dog and we're wagging the tail. Amen? Hallelujah. Did you get that? All right, let's all stand. If somebody with a loud voice who wants to pray. You got something? Okay, give me chopsticks really quick. Come on, chopsticks really quick. All right, don't forget, as I said earlier, 21-day church challenge. The brochures are in the back. Starts tomorrow. Goes every single day until Easter. And then on Easter, we're going to go to three services. We're going to shell the 8:30 service, move it to 8 o'clock, and then 1 hour in increments after that. So 9:30, could we give everybody half an hour to, you know, hug and have coffee and everything else and then get out of here so we can get the next group in? Because you know what? On that day, we're focusing on how many people we can get saved. Not how many people we can get in here, but how many we can get saved. Now, being saved does not mean signing a membership card. Being saved does not mean just raising your hand and saying a prayer. It means it's a conversion, a life-changing effect that lasts for the rest of their life. And we got to help them do it. We got to help them get connected to the boat. Amen? Who wants to pray? Who wants to be the one that prays? Don't itch your head. You'll be called forward to pray. Who wants to come up and pray? Come on. Who wants to? Come on, Chris. Chris, come on up and pray. If you don't pray, I'll call you out. Chris will pray anyway. He's got a good, loud voice. He's filled with the Holy Spirit. Pray for us, buddy, because I'm going to go to the back and hug babies and shake hands.
Pray. Yeah. Small group, stuff like that, too.
Oh, you do? Oh, good. Well, does somebody else want to join him? Go for it, buddy.
Father, thank you for bringing us here today. Thank you for teaching us of your Spirit, drawing us closer to your image. We're transformed from glory to glory. Pray you watch over us this week. Bless us. See you better. In Jesus' name.